2020 has been a very difficult year. It's easy to get discouraged or feel as if God is not there during this time of pandemic. There's a term in the corporate world called FUD, fear, uncertainty, and doubt. And it has to do with competitive situations where one company might try to instill fear, uncertainty, and doubt about one of their competitors in potential customers. And in the spiritual world, there's this type of contest as well. The Bible talks about spiritual warfare. In Ephesians 6:12, it says, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places." Satan always tries to cast fear, uncertainty, and doubt and instill that in the hearts of Christians. And we have to look at this pandemic situation and realize that there's more that's in play than just the worldly factors. Let's talk about fear a little bit. During this situation, it has been very difficult. You know, there's fear about losing jobs, losing businesses, losing livelihoods, losing income, losing freedom, losing a normal life. And there's also fear of harm. Harm to us, harm to our loved ones, the fear of losing someone we love, and even fear of death. We don't often think about death, but death is a reality that will come to us, to every one of us, eventually. It is an eventual reality, and we know that, but we push that aside. But God always tells us not to fear. Many times in the scriptures, when we hear about accounts of visitations by angels sent from God, the first thing they say is, do not fear, because the appearance of angels is awesome. When the angel Gabriel came to Mary, he said, do not fear. And this is very important because through this scripture, we know that God always reassures us not to fear. In fact, in Isaiah 41:10, it says, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will help you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. That passage summarizes words that God gave to Israel to comfort them, to encourage them. And God's attitude towards us never changes. He doesn't want us to fear. He wants us to rest assured because He is with us, because He's our God. It says, do not anxiously look about you. It's very easy for us to look around and look at the environment, look at the situation. But God doesn't change. He is our God. He will strengthen us. He will help us. He will hold us up with His righteous right hand. Now, it doesn't mean that there isn't suffering or there isn't loss. God has a lot of compassion on people, and He understands. And it's not that He doesn't care. It's not that He enjoys seeing human beings suffer. But we live in a fallen world because of sin. And the results of sin is that, you know, there's strife, there's hatred, there's illness, there's disease, there's death. But our security, our victory over fear is through knowing that God is with us, that He has not abandoned us, and He will never leave us nor forsake us. The other thing is uncertainty. You know, we don't know about certain things. We don't know when this pandemic will lift. We don't know when we can go back to our normal lives. We don't know for sure if we'll get sick or not. But our security is not in knowing what is going to happen, but in trusting God. There will come a time when we will be in God's presence and we'll see Him as He is. And we won't need to walk by faith because we already see Him. But now's not the time. While we walk on earth, we walk by faith and not by sight. In fact, in 2 Corinthians 5, verses 5 to 7, it says exactly that. Verse 7 says, for we walk by faith, not by sight. And it says that, you know, we're of good courage. And the context of those verses has to do with Paul talking about whether he would prefer to be absent from the body, that means to die from this earthly existence, and to be present with the Lord, or to stay behind and do the work that God wants him to do. But he does make a distinction that he says that while we're at home in the body, that means while we live this earthly life, we are absent from the Lord. So, you know, he wanted to be with the Lord. And he said that, you know, while we live in this body, you know, we walk by faith, not by sight. So the earthly life that we have now is a walk of faith. That means we don't know what's going to happen, but we trust God. And the scripture also says that without faith, it is impossible to please God. And the one who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of those who seek him. That's in Hebrews. And so if you look at Hebrews chapter 11, you'll find that passage, because that is the faith chapter. It talks about all the heroes of faith, people who trusted God through many difficulties and tribulations. And in the middle of that chapter, that is where we find that verse, verse 6. And I read it again. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of those who seek him. And so if you read that chapter, you'll see all the members of the great hall of faith, you know, where they trusted God. They weren't perfect, but they did trust God, and God was able to work through them to accomplish his will. Now, the last one is doubt. The doubt that we have is, you know, does God care? Is he present? Does he have compassion? Will he deliver us? Is he able to overcome the difficulties in this world when everything's falling apart? Is God with us during hard times? Does he understand our pain? And Jesus said very plainly in John 6:33 that, you know, he spoke to us many things, right? So he said, these things I have spoken to you, meaning his disciples, so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage, I have overcome the world. So in this world we will have tribulation, it's a given, but we rest assured that Christ has overcome the world. And Christ always leads us in victory. 2 Corinthians 2:14, it says, but thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumph in Christ and manifests through us the sweet aroma of the knowledge of him in every place. In every place, right? So his presence is always abiding, no matter where we are, what situation we're in. He will never leave us nor forsake us. In Hebrews 13:5-6, God's word said, you know, make sure that your character is free from the love of money, being content with what you have. And this part refers to the fact that our security and our love is not in resting in the things of this world, you know, that we have enough money, therefore we feel secure. We need to be free from the love of money. We need to be content with what we have. And it continues to say, for he himself has said, I will never desert you, nor will I ever forsake you. So the comfort, the security that we have that takes away the doubt is the fact that God will never desert us, nor will he ever forsake us. And verse 6 says, so that we confidently say, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What will man do to me? This is talking about the fear of man, but the principle applies to things beyond people, that we're not afraid no matter what, because God is with us. And when Moses, before he died, blessed the sons of Israel and gave words of blessing and encouragement to the tribe of Asher, he said, and this is in Deuteronomy 33, verse 27, he says, the eternal God is a dwelling place, and underneath are the everlasting arms. So he talks about the fact that God is with them, and no matter what enemies they faced, they do not need to be afraid, because God's everlasting arms were underneath to hold them up, to catch them. Basically, he was saying, God's got you. You don't need to worry. And in 1 Peter 5, we find out that God gives us relief from stress, that he doesn't want us to be anxious. He doesn't want us to be afraid. He wants us to cast our anxiety on him. Starting in verse 6 of 1 Peter chapter 5, it says, therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time, casting all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. So, and then it goes on to talk about the spiritual warfare, how, you know, Satan wants to intimidate us. He's the adversary, the devil, who prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. But it goes on to say that we are to resist the devil, firm in our faith, you know, knowing that the experiences of suffering are being accomplished by Christians all over the world, right? And then after we suffer through it, the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself perfect, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. That means, you know, through the trials that we have, God perfects our character. So with these passages that address fear, uncertainty, and doubt, what kind of perspective, what kind of purpose do we come out of it? Do we just go through it and say, oh God, just get us through this? God never intended us to just endure and survive, but through the endurance to gain something greater. And this pandemic gives us some perspective. I hope that when we come out of this pandemic, that we will not forget these lessons from God's word. First of all, that life here is not forever. Seeing all the deaths from COVID-19 makes us realize that we don't have forever here. So we have to make it count, right? There's a window of time that we have here on earth to honor God, to live for him, and to invest in things that are eternal, that last forever. We need to reprioritize, you know, and what will we change when we go back, quote unquote, to normal? Will we live life differently because of this experience? Will we gain some wisdom? In James 4:14, it says, yet you do not know what your life will be like tomorrow. You're just a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. We are like a breath that vanishes away, like grass that fades. But we will have an eternity with God after we die and leave this earth. So therefore, the way that we live now, we want to live in a way that there will be eternal benefit and eternal honoring of God. First of all, what do? We endure. Yes, we do have to endure. In James 1, it says that we are to consider it all joy when we encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of our faith, and you know, we talked about how we walk by faith and not by sight, produces endurance. And it says to let endurance have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. The word perfect means mature, that you may mature spiritually and that you lack nothing. And it says, but if anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives generously and without reproach. So when we have trials, we don't just endure, but we try to learn something from it to gain wisdom, so we can ask God for that. But it says to let that person ask in faith without any doubt. And here again, we talk about faith and we talk about doubt. It says that for he who doubts is like the surf of the sea, tossed to and fro by the wind. Let not that man expect that he will receive anything from the Lord. So we have to ask in faith. So, you know, while we go through this, we need to not only endure, but we need to ask God to give us wisdom. And it's very important, because in Psalm 90:12, it says, so teach us to number our days. So knowing that our life is short, that we have this window of opportunity, that we may present to you a heart of wisdom. So hopefully, as we live life as Christians, as we walk with the Lord, that we gain in wisdom, that we're much wiser, you know, decades down the road than when we were younger. And part of wisdom is knowing priorities, what really matters. Because life is short and there's a life beyond, what do we do again in this window of time that can have eternal benefit? Well, number one, our character, becoming more like Christ. When people see that there's a transformation in us that is taking place, that we're conformed to the image of Christ, as it says in Romans 8:29, and that, you know, we live as living sacrifices, you know, Romans 12:1, for God's glory, then, you know, we're able to represent the sanctifying, transforming power of the gospel. Our witness to others about the hope that we have in Christ depends on that. If we say the truth about the gospel, somehow people still look at us, what kind of people we are, how has it transformed our lives. It's not very convincing if we talk about God's love, but we ourselves are full of resentment or bitterness and hatred. So our character matters, right? And our witness matters, right? Our witness in 1 Peter 3:15, it says that we are to sanctify Christ as Lord in our hearts, that process that I talked about in terms of character. As we sanctify Christ, you know, as we set him apart as Lord in our hearts, he will purify us. Then it says we will always being ready to make a defense to anyone who asks to give an account for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and reverence. If our character really reflects Christ-likeness, people will much more likely ask us, hey, why do you have such hope? What is the hope that you have in Christ? And then with gentleness and reverence, we should always be ready to give a reason for the hope that we have. that because Christ died for our sins and we have received him as Lord and Savior, we have a different perspective. And it's a life transforming relationship with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. So it's our character, our witness, and those two are interrelated. And then our works. We are not saved because of any good works, but because we're saved, that salvation that God instilled in us, that gave us, that salvation pours out through the way that we live, through the things that we do. So again, salvation is free, and there's nothing we can do at all to earn God's favor. It is given to us, right? Salvation is a free gift by faith. But once we're saved, that salvation works itself out in our lives through the things that we do. In Ephesians 2:8, it says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast." So it's very clear that our salvation depends on God's grace and not through any good works of ours. We don't deserve to go to heaven. And in verse 10, it goes on to say in Ephesians 2, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works." That means God has a plan for you to do certain works, to be a steward of all the spiritual gifts and talents and resources that he has given you. "Created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them." So God has planned certain works that he wants you to do for his glory. And so we need to take some time to have this perspective and purpose and ask, "Lord, what is it that you want me to do?" And starting now, but especially when the pandemic lifts, to not forget that sense of calling. He has a set of works that he has prepared beforehand for each one of us who follow him. And then it also talks about this working out of our salvation. That means, you know, manifesting the fact that we're saved by grace. In Philippians 2:13-14, it says, "So then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling." Work it out. That means let your salvation show. Not that you work in order to gain salvation, but because you're saved, that salvation spills over into your life in the works that you do. So we work out our salvation with fear and trembling. "For it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure." And so this passage talks about how God is at work in us. He's prepared works beforehand for us, and he's at work in us to want to do his will and to work, you know, the works that he wants us to do for his good pleasure. In other words, to bring him glory, to please him. And it continues to say in verse 14, "Do all things without grumbling or disputing." So one of the ways we can tell if we're on track is we're complaining, grumbling, disputing, arguing, criticizing a lot, you know, whether it's inside the church or at home or with colleagues, complaining. That's a sign that we're not on the right track, because the way that God works in us, when we serve him, we don't complain, we don't grumble, we do it with joy, and we do it to please him for his good pleasure. And we have a race to run here. As I said, this is a brief time in eternity, just this brief window. And when Paul was about to die, he wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 to 8. He talks about how he gave it his all. He ran that race for God's glory. He said, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. In the future, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day." That means the day of judgment. "And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing." Now, when we as Christians appear before God in the last judgment, we will not be condemned. We have already been saved. We have already been forgiven. We have already been made right with God. The judgment is only for the works that we do that are positive things for God's kingdom. And he'll give us a crown of righteousness, which we'll lay at Jesus' feet and give him glory and give it all back to him. But this is talking about the reward for the works that we do, not for our salvation, but as an expression of our gratitude that God saved us, to fulfill the works that he prepared beforehand for us to do. And it's my hope we will all seek God's purpose and calling for us and do those works that he planned beforehand, so that when we see him face to face, just like the master said to the slave in the parable of the servants and the talents in Matthew 25, the servant that invested the talents and brought more kind of returns with them, the master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And so my hope is, you know, when I see the Lord, is that anything that I've done for him, and hopefully everything that I could give, and giving him my all, that he will say the words I long to hear, which is, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master." And I hope that will be the desire of your heart too. So as we conclude this difficult year, and as we look ahead, as we face our fears, you know, knowing that God is with us, as we face uncertainty and we walk by faith, as we face our doubt by relying on the goodness and the faithfulness and the character of God, I pray that through all that, God will comfort us and give us victory in Christ over fear, uncertainty, and doubt, and also give us a new perspective and purpose as we head into the new year, so that we might do the works that God planned for us to do beforehand to bring him good pleasure and to give him all the glory and honor and to continue to run this race for his glory. And so may God's word give us hope for the future, not only for the future in this life, but for all eternity. God bless you and Happy New Year. May God do great things in and through you in this new year to overflowing. May he bless you abundantly, and may you give him all the glory. Amen.